is Gene Resnick, and it's my pleasure to be with you here today. I first want to thank Tomorrow Street and Warwick for hosting this wonderful event. It's my pleasure to be here. I also want to congratulate Vodafone Procurement Company for their 10 years in Luxembourg, and it's a pleasure to be here for such a joyous event. My job at Accenture is simple. My job is to really build partnerships that Accenture can bring to our clients to really help them, you know, become digital businesses. And what does that ecosystem look like? How do startups work into that? How do big companies work into that? And fundamentally, how does Accenture connect and bring the best of the ecosystem to our clients? And that's an exciting time. It exposes me to mature technology companies. It exposed me to startups. And I really want to share with you a little bit about, you know, how we view sort of the relationship between corporates and startups, right? That's the topic for the conference. That's the topic, you know, for my speech. And I think how to work together clearly is not a simple answer, right? All the preconditions seem to be there, right? Digital disruption is everywhere. Innovation is the name of the game. Big corporations have realized that that externalizing their innovation and R&D is an important part of how they move faster. Yet the connection, as we heard from Warwick and others, isn't necessarily clean, and it's hard to find the right way to connect and to have joint success. So I will present this topic from two perspectives. I think first, I'll share with you sort of how we see our corporate customers working with startups, what are some of the lessons learned, how they incorporate it, right? And at the same time, I will share with you how Accenture, which is also a large corporate, thinks about how we work with startups, right? So from our perspective and from the client's perspective. So let me maybe start off by giving you anatomy of a big corporate named Accenture to get grounded in what makes this, you know, hard to really, to really strike the right balance in. So a little bit about Accenture. For those of you that are maybe less familiar with us, our story starts roughly in the late 80s, 1989 to be precise, when Anderson Consulting was made a separate division of Arthur Anderson, who at the time was one of the leading accounting companies in the world. Anderson Consulting formed under the premise of driving information technology and having that be the core of its business. And in 2001, Anderson Consulting became public, formally split off from Arthur Anderson to become Accenture. At the time, Accenture, when it went public, and it was, by the way, the last tech IPO of 2001. We went public in July, 3 months before September 11th, and right before the internet bubble burst. So one of the last IPOs before September 11th was Accenture. And at the time, we were $10 billion in revenue. We were roughly 70,000 people. So 17 years later, right, we sort of have ridden the waves and worked with our clients through ERP and global operating models and offshore and business process reengineering. And today we stand at $35 billion in revenue, roughly 400,000 people, 200 locations serving clients across 40 industries. You see roughly 5,000 clients. And the next wave for us, well, again, that's a very big company. And now you know, like everybody else, you got to move to the new, you got to move to digital, you have to move to innovation. And that's really where our energy is focused. And how do we really evolve as a business, change our propositions, make sure that we're relevant to our clients, help them navigate the digital disruption? And how do we work with our technology partners and startups to really accomplish that? So in our organization, we've created what we call the Accenture Innovation Architecture, which are the capabilities that we're investing in, that we're building to really, you know, equip ourselves and equip our clients really for digital disruption. So if you look at some of the key components, right, you know, there's a research dimension where we're studying and looking at thought leadership around things like blockchain and quantum computing, artificial intelligence, et cetera. Accenture Ventures, which is the group I'm responsible in, which works with startups, makes equity investments in startups, and really makes sure that we're connected to the innovation happening in the VC world. Accenture Labs, that does a lot of the prototypes and drives that. Our studios, innovation centers, delivery centers, and this entire set of capabilities is really how we bring innovation to our clients and really help them tackle what what is, you know, clearly in every industry that we serve is the name of the game. And the name of the game is digital disruption, right? So the corporate backdrop, you know, this is a famous quote from Jamie Dimon. You know, at the time it was Silicon Valley, but now, of course, it's also the East Coast of China. It's also Israel. It's also Luxembourg for the next couple of days. But fundamentally, startups and innovation is coming out of a lot of different centers of the world. And whether your financial services being disrupted by mobile money, by cryptocurrencies, whether you're in the telecom industries, you know, wrestling with over-the-top providers, whether you're in retail, you know, wrestling with Amazon and Alibaba, Airbnb, Uber, et cetera, right? The name of the game is disruption, and innovation, and startup innovation particularly, is absolutely central. And in most of these industries, in most corporates, Accenture included, we're all working really hard, right? We're all working really hard to look like unicorns and compete with unicorns. And ultimately, right, recognizing the fact that they're, you know, born on the web, they're digitally native, they don't have incumbency, they have the right talent, they have the right culture. Big companies are working very hard right now to really, you know, train themselves to be in shape to compete with those. And there's two types of unicorns, right? There's the unicorns that you look at that are there whose entire business model is to disrupt what you've done successfully, and those are the competitors. And increasingly, they're unicorns that are being built to help big companies compete with those unicorns, right? So, you know, you're looking at ways to reinvent yourself in your training to really make sure you're relevant for the future. So all of that drives the VC market, the IPO market, and of course we see and participate in a lot of the activity that we're seeing around the space. So number one, I mean, clearly the IPOs are up, which is good news for this entire group. Year to date, there have been 16 tech IPOs. I think there was, you know, three last Friday, the biggest one being DocuSign, right? So the IPO market is up. It's double what it was at this time last year. Last year there was 8 at this time. This year there's 16. Last year the amount of money raised was $4 billion. Year to date it's $8 billion. Right, so clearly the IPO market is quite active. For those of you that saw the press this morning, Xiaomi, who's got a booth down there, announced their IPO, right, in the mobile phone space. So that's gonna continue, right, and that's driving more and more investment, that's driving more and more activity, and you know, there's a lot of brands out there that are looking to go to the public markets to, you know, sort of, you know, achieve sort of their end goal. Corporate investment is growing, right? So last year there was about $150 billion of VC money. Corporates made up $31 billion of that. So roughly 20% of all money that's going into startups is coming from corporates. Accenture, like many other corporates, is investing in startups. You see it's 3x what it was just 5 years ago. So corporates have realized, right, you know, putting money into their own development or putting money into startups and getting close to it, I think the latter makes a lot more sense. So more and more money is flowing into it. The third area is China. China tech is clearly growing. I mean, of course, you know, we have the big companies like Huawei, you know, that have really made a name for the Baidu, the Tencent, the Alibaba, that have really, the ZTE, that have been a longtime champions of China technology. But if you look at the VC market right now in China, right, roughly $40 billion was invested last year. To get out of about 150, so about 25%. 2,200 deals last year, whereas 10 years ago it was 100. So 2,200 deals were done, you know, by Chinese investors last year. You know, some of them, the numbers have gotten, you know, very high. For those of you that follow the AI space, probably have seen SenseTime. SenseTime is the Chinese AI leader. They just raised a round of $600 million, Series C, which followed a Series B last July of $400 million. So in 9 months, they've raised $1 billion, and they're only at Series C, right? So you sort of look at that, and you look at the scale and the size of the investments, and you sort of recognize that Chinese tech and Chinese startup in China, right, is coming on in a very, very big way. And again, you know, have to deal with sort of some of the battlegrounds and some of the, you know, geopolitical issues, but fundamentally, there's a tremendous amount of money and innovation coming out of China. And then finally, the unicorns are starting to shift to B2B, right? Initially, it was a lot of B2C disruption. but now we're seeing more companies that are ultimately focused on helping corporates in the B2B world enable them to be, you know, to be better competitors, right? So if you look at this venture activity, I mean, there's a lot happening, and again, every year it's getting bigger, and then I think this year the expectation is all of the numbers that are displayed here are going to continue to grow pretty aggressively. However, you know, sort of, you know, all those preconditions still sort of create this dynamic that taking a company with several hundred thousand employees with tens of billions of revenue and trying to connect it to somebody with, you know, a fraction of that has been difficult. And this was a study that was done. And again, you take a look at some of the questions, you know, interaction is mission critical, right? So for startups, of course, getting involved with a corporate, connecting to them, trying to make them a lighthouse account or a charter account, 67% of them view that as absolutely essential to their success. And that makes sense. To a corporate, right, they're working with a lot of different priorities internally, they're working with a number of startups, they're more experimenting, they're more doing POCs, and it's sort of this imbalance of expectations, an imbalance of really the pace at which they need to be moving that I think is creating a lot of tension. And that's, you know, that's a challenge, and you see, you know, of course the startups want to develop a strategic partnership, and again, for the corporates, it's more about getting a sense of where the market is going, and I wouldn't call it necessarily, for a lot of the things that we see, I wouldn't necessarily call some of it mission critical, right? It's a bit, some adjacent spaces, they're experimenting, they're looking to understand, and again, that creates challenges for small companies looking to really latch on and have success. So just a few things that I think that we would advocate around this, right? Number one, if you're a startup, focusing on value and being very, very clear. Startups tend to be extremely clear in their elevator pitch to investors, to VCs. We would advocate being very clear to the pitch and the value proposition and why should the corporate care as a core element of what they do. You know, business cases, how value is created, which KPIs of the corporate they're really helping them move. I think clear understanding of that, clear communication around that, we view as absolutely central, right, to sort of cut through the noise and sort of get down to, you know, fundamentally, where's the value of the particular relationship? Number two, strong partnerships. I think what you're going to find, if we all see this, most corporates right now are looking to latch on to and strike relationships with a handful of strategic partners. So whether it's Google, Microsoft, Amazon, SAP, Oracle, Salesforce, they're anchoring around a handful of technology platforms on which they're going to build their next generation business. And I think for startups, our guidance and our direction would be to form those, really understand, you know, first of all, what that ecosystem is for the corporate with which they're working, and then secondly, make sure they have a very clean story of how they integrate, how they connect, how they have relationships and you know, with a particular ecosystem partner. Same with SIs, right? So most companies have standardized on a few SIs that they work with for most of their technology deployments. I think understanding that if you're a startup is central. So again, if Accenture is one of the key systems implementers, I think having a very good relationship and a partnership with Accenture, having Accenture people trained on the technology, those are the kinds of things that really help sort of ease the interaction. And then finally, I think customer success is key, right? I mean, at the end of the day, you will be given a chance to deliver some innovative projects with a customer. Make sure that it ultimately hits the mark, right? Because a lot of POCs we see, you sort of ask, how did it go? It went okay. Okay is not a reason that they ask startups to come back. It has to be great. It really has to blow their socks off, and I think that's really important. And the final point, listening to Warwick earlier this morning, that I do want to sort of add to this, which is, I think finding the right individual to work with is also very important. We talk about corporations, it's not corporations, it's individuals. And finding the change agents and the leaders of the particular company with whom you're working that ultimately are the disruptors in the company, that are moving the needles in the company, is absolutely key, right? So I would think about it less as corporates and more who are the right people to be spending time with at those corporates that fundamentally will drive the transformation agenda. So to summarize, right, I mean, I think we see a very fertile environment. We see a lot of dancing between startups and corporates. We expect the pace of the dance to be accelerated. Maybe we get into some different rhythms, but fundamentally, right, this whole dynamic of how do you externalize innovation, How do you bring it into a big, complicated company? How do you drive the value out of it? It's really an important dynamic that we do believe is central to the digital transformation of most of our customers. And again, it's very exciting to be here discussing this topic. So nice to be here with all of you. Look forward to the rest of the day and enjoy the rest of the conference. Thank you.